First of all, thanks a lot for the organizers for giving me this opportunity to be here. I'm going to talk about some of the work we're doing on nanophotonics, especially in trying to enable low-cost sensing right at the point of care use. This work is being commercialized through a startup company coming out of a group called Nanolytics. The papers are being signed right now this week, like all the term agreements and everything are being done this week. And the company would be launched next week onwards. The outline of my talk begins with some introduction of the problems we are trying to solve, talk about a couple of technologies which we are using in a vertically integrated platform for a multitude of applications, and then conclude. A research overview of a lab, we do quite a variety of things. Normally, the very focus of a lab is always on developing platform technologies and then try to see if we can apply it from other places. So we start from very fundamental physics level and then we go into engineering after that. We have been successful in developing monolithic integration platforms for photonic devices, integrating active and passive devices. A couple of these platforms are commercialized, are being used for commercial devices today. We are one of the two groups in the world who can do mid-infrared interband cascade lasers at high power, 100 milliwatts or above, the other being Jerry Myers' group in Naval Research Laboratory. A large part of our group is working on semiconductor nanostructures, and this work started at very fundamental level where we wanted to see, understand how optical properties like dispersion, wave guiding, non-linearities would change when we go to nanostructures. And right at the beginning, our goal was to see where would nano make sense in photonic devices, in real world applications. We just didn't want to do it for the fun of it. We wanted to come out with answers where this would actually make sense in real world devices. And the work which I'm going to talk about today comes partly out of this work. And then we have been working on chemical biosensing and environmental monitoring, basically using the devices we build in these three structures and then start looking for their applications. From the research output point of view, there are already three startup companies which have which have been successful out of our research. The first being Covega Corporation, which was venture capital funded right out of my PhD in 2000. And today exists as ThorLab Quantum Electronics. If you have bought a semiconductor laser from ThorLabs, it was designed and built in this company. The second one was mainly out of my undergraduate research. And it was a company where we built optical systems for basically taking Ethernet into metro applications. And this technology was sold and transferred to a major cable MSO out of Atlanta, Georgia. And the third company came out of our first work in nanostructures. When we started working on these nanostructures, we found that we couldn't really measure them. The standard methods of measuring were not really applicable. So we had to develop our own techniques. And out of that came Innometrix Incorporated, which is run by one of my students. It's out of Hamilton, Ontario, and founded in 2008. Has raised about $500,000 of funding and is employing about five people right now. In terms of our work on nanophotonics for sensing applications, this is the vision I laid for my lab about 3 years ago. What we wanted to do was, we wanted to create some simple elegant solutions, but we still wanted to keep the performance high. As much as possible, keep the performance at a lab grade instrument. But the idea was that these solutions should be directly usable by an ordinary user who is not trained in science or technology. And the goal should be to try to improve the quality of life and ensure safety and well-being of ordinary citizens. So when we laid out this vision about 3 years ago, we started thinking what we can do, and something which comes first to your mind is, Well, a cell phone or smartphone is probably used by most of the people these days. Even a country like India, there are about 100 million smartphones in the people's hands. A smartphone has a very, very good camera in it. A smartphone has a GPS tag, and it has a better computing power than the computers I used when I was doing my PhD. So why can't we use those things which are already available and build solutions around it? And that's how we came up with this vision. And we started looking at the developing world first rather than the developed world, because one, the technology challenges were so much different. The technology which in the developing world and mainly looking for contaminants, in the developing world, I'm mainly looking for adulterants. Somebody has actually went and added something nasty to your stuff. Whereas in developed world, I'm looking at contaminants. Something you have accidentally fallen in. So the technology challenges were quite different. So we thought, well, let's go and build it for developing countries, and then we'll learn more about technology as it's being applied, and we can keep on improving it, and then later bring it to the developed world. So we went to India, and we found out that if you take a look at India, 68% of water in India today is contaminated from things like arsenic, phosphorus, nitrates, to viruses, to pathogens. Chances are if you're drinking water in India, you are really affecting your health. Over 186,000 kids die yearly due to acute diarrhea under the age of 5. People who don't need to die, which are very preventable solutions. 600 million is lost annually in loss production. If you take a look at food, 80% of milk in India is adulterated. The adulteration could be as simple as water being added to dilute it. Two, something called synthetic milk, which is nothing but a chemical concoction with about 5 to 10% milk and has chemicals like detergents, urea, fats, hydrogenated fats. It tastes like milk, it looks like milk, has about 5 to 10% milk, and chemicals which are going to kill your kidneys within 5 to 6 years. Edible oils. Most of the edible oils being sold there are again adulterated with palm oil, normally with palm oil because it's a cheap oil substrate. The adulteration is anywhere between 10 to 90%. So if you buy a sunflower oil, chances are 10% of it is palm oil, or it could be even 90% palm oil. And this palm oil is a colorless oil, so it's very difficult to see whether it has been adulterated with. If you take a look at vegetables like peas, they have been added, color has been added to it to give it a green color so that it sells better. So you see, these problems are quite acute, are affecting the human conditions quite badly. If you come to the North American context, with the food being commercialized, large factories, large areas, there's a huge issue, there's a significant human risk to various bacteria which start to contaminate the food over time. For example, in US itself, there are roughly 750,000 cases of E. coli, 4 million cases annually of Salmonella, and so forth and so on. People getting hospitalized, and some even dying because they ate contaminated food. So our goal at that point was, well, if you can find a simple solution, some you can carry in your pocket, connect it to your cell phone, and check for your food, check for your water, check for your edible oils before you're buying it, and see if you can come up with a solution like that, it could really affect human impact life. And we could really do something good about it. And out of that comes two technologies which we have developed, or two platforms of technologies. One are nanophotonic chips, and these chips are these chips create very strong structural colors, as I show you. These chips are like almost like butterfly wings. We can create almost any color. But what happens is that if there is a change on the boundary of the chip, if a new dielectric material comes and sits on the chip, the color of the chip changes. So by just taking a simple picture before and after the event and seeing whether the color has changed, we can do very qualitative analysis. We can see something wrong has happened, and Well, it's better you boil this water before you drink it, for example, if there was a pathogen in the water. The reason these colors are created is because we create certain spectral shifts using surface plasmonics. And these spectral shifts shift 600 nanometers per RIU, per refractive index unit change. So if we measure it spectrally, then we can do quantitative measurements too. And the very same reason we generate the colors, we also generate a very highly localized electric field right on the top surface of the chip. So the RAM of any molecule which comes on the chip gets highly surface enhanced. We have seen enhancement up to 10 billion. So if you take a Raman signature of a molecule in nascent state as opposed to putting it on a chip. So what this chip allows us to now do is create a modular level of sensing. At very, very simple levels, it's just a simple image. And it just gives you a qualitative answer. There is something wrong. Please be careful. To a place where we can use the source and we can do fingerprinting of the molecules on it with a very, very simple low-cost spectrometers. The cell phone, so basically when we were doing this shift, we also realized if we want to do these measurements, we need a spectrometer, so why don't we go and build it ourselves? So we have built spectrometers which either made for cell phones or actually use the camera of the cell phone itself. And these spectrometers have better than 0.3 nanometer spectral resolution. If you're using the camera of the cell phone, they only work in the visible range 350 to 670 nanometers. If you use our own web cameras, they work up to 1100 nanometers range. We designed all the critical components, including the grating and the slits in-house. The gratings are costing us less than $1 to build. They have an efficiency of about 75% over the visible range. And this integration of these two technologies provide us a vertically integrated solution with which we can start to now look at various different markets. The first market we are looking at is water in the Indian domain, looking for harmful effects in water. So Nanolytics, which is being formed this week, is working on food and water safety, which is to detect adulterants and pathogens. And at its very simple level, it uses cell phone, only the cell phone spectrometer with some UV lasers or laser pointers, with more consumables for ordinary users, and then integrated with nanophotonic chips for quantitative measurements for regulatory and testing laboratories. So we create a modular testing system that way. The way we build the cell phone spectrometer, it uses a two-dimensional camera, so we can actually do multispectral imaging, and we have started to look. So this work is going to be started to commercialize with Nanolytics next week onwards. This work is what we are developing within our research lab itself. And one area we're looking at is to look for detection of rot, see whether the beef you're buying has been sitting around for time or is fresh before you buy it. We're looking at biochemical sensing, including microbiology and lab on chips, which we expect to develop over the next 2 to 3 years. We are also looking at medical imaging, especially for hyperspectral imaging for detection of cancer skins. You have the cell phone with a small attachment to it. You take an image of the mole, and then you can, the image of the mole has all the spectra information in it. You can send it to a dermatologist. You can make a decision whether you need to see somebody immediately, or you can go and buy a cream and use it off the market. And a second company is coming about in a month. We are just finalizing the funding areas in there, which is going to focus on education and research. Take these spectrometers to high schools and university labs for hands-on educations. Take these spectrometers all the way down to elementary school. We run a science club in a high school, a middle school in Waterloo, and any student who joins my group has to be part of that science club. And we have been developing these tools within that science club, within these students within the science club, and we will be taking this further. When we started this, it was quite surprising to us that a simple color sensing can work very well. Especially if you are in the right wavelength region, which is about here, about 590 nanometers. And in this wavelength region, the color changes from green to red very, very quickly. And an average human eye can detect a 1 nanometer shift of spectra just by looking at the color if you are about 590 nanometers. Not only that, if you take, this is an experiment where we took some of our chips, and this is the color, this is experiment, this is theoretical. As we change the refractive index of the surrounding medium around the chip, the color changes. And if we decompose it into red, green, and blue, what you find is that the red really does not change, the blue does not change, the green changes nearly linearly with the refractive index. So you can even do some simple quantitative analysis by just taking an image if you're in the right spectral region. Very, very simple quantitative analysis. We can resolve about 10 to power minus 3 changes of refractive index by just taking an image and decomposing it into RGB components and then looking for the change in the green component within that. The cell phone spectrometer, this is one of our first generation cell phone spectrometer. It's built around an iPhone, this particular one, but we have built it on iPhone and Android applications. This one is a lab-grade spectrometer, so it is, the phone is completely enclosed, but there are other spectrometers where the optics component just comes like a tube in front of the camera, or there are spectrometers we have built where we have a web camera which takes the image, and we use a USB or a Bluetooth to connect to the cell phone. The form factors, we have spectrometers which are about 1 inch to about 2 inches in base diameter, and roughly the width of the phone in its height. The camera on the smartphone or a web camera, about a $10 web camera, is used to capture the spectral data. And we develop all our optical components, including the gratings. The gratings are volume phase gratings working in transmission, which allows us to create small form factors. We do not need to fold the beams around. The gratings are fabricated with our own recipe, have about 95% yield. We can write about 1,800 lines per millimeter with an efficiency of 74%, diffraction efficiency of 74% over the visible range, complete visible range. It's a very, very low cost process. The grating uses a laser which has been bought off eBay. It uses stuff, the total setup is about $1,300. To make this grating, and it costs us about, each grating is about 10 second exposure time compared to about 5 minutes to 10 minutes which is normally done in industry, so it costs us about less than a dollar per grating to make. Because we are taking a two-dimensional image, we live with the optical aberrations. So we use very, very low-cost optics. We don't try to have aberration-free optics. We can correct for that in image processing. We see these aberrations very clearly in an image, and we can correct for that very easily in image processing. We have designed some low stray-like designs. And once we started working on it, we found that this 2D arrays actually give us advantage over the commercial spectrometers. One, this 2D array, what it does is, it allows us averaging the signal over space rather than over time. We are taking the signal as a two-dimensional image, we can take different cuts through that same time, and we can average it over that, so we can reduce the noise that way. So it allows us faster, lower noise measurements. We can also use it for multi-channel integration by connecting optical fibers in a linear fashion onto the CCD camera, each fiber sensing its own environment. And then we can do hyperspectral imaging. The same thing here, but at the output, the fibers are arranged in a cylindrical pixelated form, and thus you can just take that fiber on top of whatever image you want, and you get a multi pixelated image, but with various selective area. Just as an example, here is a CFL lamp measured with a spectrometer. This is basically the various mercury lines, and you can see that we can resolve very, very sharp peaks, very, very close together. We were able to resolve all the peaks which are there in the NIST database. this is an example of oil adulteration. Basically, here we put a UV laser, a $5 UV laser through the oil sample, and what it does is we're measuring the fluorescence coming out of the oil sample, and in presence of parmalin, we start to see a fluorescence. In this specific case, it was about 0.1% parmalin added in extra virgin olive oil. So by just looking at the fluorescence, we can start to look at the data. Here is an example of a multi-channel spectral image where you basically have each, we have multiple optical fibers arranged in a linear fashion, and each optical fiber could either be coming from a different channel or arranged in a multi pixel form. From the sensor chip point of view, we have been using surface plasmonics, which is an electromagnetic wave we can guide between a dielectric and a metallic semiconductor and a metallic form. But our innovation comes in, one, using a two-dimensional grating. So what this does is, all we need to do is we shine the light from the top with a white LED. And because of this two-dimensional grating, we can excite localized surface plasmonic resonances, which get coupled into this chip, and the rest pass through this chip. The other innovation we have done is putting a metallic mirror right below this two-dimensional grating. So this layer here is a metallic mirror. What that does is it basically forces the electric field to go to zero, and by adjusting this height correctly, it forces the complete hot spot to be right at the top region here. The second thing it does is basically when you shine the light, if the light is not excited into this localized surface plasmonic resonance, the light is reflected back, so we start removing spectral components and we start creating unique colors within this chip. Just if we were using the grating on just a simple dielectric mirror like glass, you have hot spots right at the top and the bottom. In fact, the stronger hot spots happen here. But whereas by using this metallic mirror and by adjusting this height appropriately, we can push the complete electric field hotspot to be right at the top where the material is going to be added, and thus we can increase the sensitivity quite appreciably. Let me just, out of time. This is some of the chips as their dimensions are changed, and we can generate almost any colors from reds to greens. We didn't go into the blue region because that wasn't of interest for us, but we can generate very, very vivid colors. And in terms of sensing, these vivid colors, they start to change as we put different materials. In this case, it's a bulk sensing where we are putting oils of different refractive indexes. In this case, it's surface sensing. We put thin layers of silicon dioxide on top of the chip, and the color changes from red to green with only 20 nanometers of silicon dioxide added. And the last one is we localize some E. coli, a single E. coli bacteria right on the chip, and you can see that as a color change happening. It's almost as if a bomb blast has happened on the chip. Here is an experiment which will probably not show well on this projector, but this was a DNA hybridization. This is before the hybridization happened, this is after the hybridization happened, and we see a color change. So we can do that kind of microbiology by just looking at color changes. And this one is virus detection, soybean bean pot model virus detection. Here we were measuring the spectra, and we see within 30 minutes we can go and measure the presence of this this virus at about 10 nanograms per milliliter concentrations. The very same reason we generate the colors, we also create a highly enhanced surface enhanced Raman spectrum of any molecule sitting on the chip. Here is one of our chips, which is a crescent in shape, has an effective analytical enhancement factor of 10 million, as opposed to gold, which is gold nanoparticles, which is somewhere here. This measurement was done at 10 nanomolars. This measurement was done at 10 micromolars. So there is a huge difference. And this SIRs are point polarization independent. So it does not matter how we align these chips to the electric field of the input laser, making it hopefully more user friendly. And if we map it over over the array, we get quite high uniformity, which is basically due to our fabrication processes. We don't get signals from the edge, which is edge effects, the periodic boundary conditions break there, but in the heart of the chip, we do get very, very good uniformity. So in conclusion, our vision is that we believe cell phones or smartphones can revolutionize biochemical sensing. Food and water safety is a major thing for us, and we're going to start commercializing this for that immediately. Nanophotonic chips enabled, combined with cell phones, can enable next generation sensors on the most ubiquitous platforms we have today. Thanks a lot for your attention and open to any questions.